Alright guys, today we're going to be installing this fun toy inside of this fun toy and see how it compares performance wise and whether or not it lives up to its expectations and its promise of plus 16 plus 24. Granted, I'm not going to be dynoing it, but I should certainly hoping to feel it. The current mods on the 18 Grand Cherokee Altitude performance wise are only a K&N drop-in filter and a single catback exhaust from Borla. So let's see how it goes.
If every day goes like this, how do we survive?
Okay, so the unboxing experience, actually very well packed by AFE. I'm just going to take out a whole bunch of packing paper and have a look here at the engraved Momentum GT AFE, the actual filter box, as well as the components that are going to be making out the tube and the connectors and all of that. So we're going to unpack this a little further and get a closer look. Okay, so what do we have here? Have a really nice large air filter cone. This one is dry air filter cone as opposed to oiled. I'm sure there are different schools of thought on why one kind may be better than the other. Of course, with AFE for this application, they're saying that you can theoretically go for either one if you have a preference for one reason or other. Again, the actual air box, which is pretty cool looking. Aside from cool looking, it seems very well put together, no matter how you look at it. And one of the reasons we decided to do a closed air box as opposed to open is because of potential heat sink. This is not truly a cold air filter, so we're not dropping this down into the wheel well, so it's sitting in the engine bay, and depending on the school of thought you believe in, having an air take inside the engine compartment that is not well insulated creates heat sink and actually gives you power drop. Even those engines and some of the other filters that you can put in, intake filters, even those, if not properly insulated, some can make an argument are sucking in more air, but they're sucking in more hot air. So are we really getting a power gain there, or if in fact power loss? Let's just agree to disagree, regardless of what you believe in. So hopefully this air box is more robust than the factory one. What's also cool here is you have this window that allows you to look in, supposedly, and take a look at the condition of the filter without having to take the box off when you're looking to replace it. A potential mod coming up from Illumination Auto, check them out at Illumination Auto on Instagram, is an installation of an LED light inside of the compartment so that when the hood pops open, you can more clearly see what's going on inside the airbox. Anyway, the actual tube itself, the intake, again, with a nice engraved plate to show the brand. Seems fairly straightforward. Your series of clamps for the cone filter and for the connections. The rubber connector, and of course the hose itself. And then we have, needless to say, instructions, plus they're available online on their website, some type of warranty card for records for the filter itself, and a couple of trinkets from AFE Power. So we're gonna go and try to get all this put together into the engine bay. So here we have the factory setup of the Altitude. Yeah, of course I should have mentioned it's a V6. It's not the V8, it's not SRT, and that's okay. I don't mind that one bit, that much more fun. The insides are in fairly good shape here. Again, here's where the factory air intake actually comes through from underneath the hood, leading to the air flowing into the airbox, where we currently have a K&N drop-in filter. Again, I thought it was a pretty good minimal mod to make at the time, but like I said, I decided to go a little bit more extreme. Of course, the factory tube itself that everybody who tries to mod argues these wrinkles create some air discrepancies when the intake sucks it into the engine. So the one thing that I don't think everybody realizes is that the reason for these wrinkles and these flexes is partly to increase the surface area without having to stretch the tube out. And the increase in the surface area allows for cooling of the surround that much better when the engine's hot or when the air is coming in, so that the cooling happens more efficiently than if this were straight. Still, the replacement air box and the replacement tube are going to be completely smooth, as you saw before. The one catch, based on how this is currently constructed, based on instructions, you actually would have to potentially, we'll see if we will need to take off this front cover for the engine, but you would definitely end up needing to take off the top cover to be able to connect the replacement tube. The taking off piece happens after popping this piece right here, and I think finagling the actual engine cover itself. We'll take a look at that. And then supposedly you should be able to replace the engine cover even after you've replaced the stock intake with the AFE GT series. And I also happen to appreciate that, because based on some of the other intake systems, it appears that when you install those, you actually are no longer able to replace the engine cover. And to me, that's important, might not be to you all. Initial set of disassembly instructions of the factory setup seem relatively straightforward. As I mentioned before, here's them referencing popping the top cover off of the engine cover to be able to loosen the screw here that's holding the whole thing down, and then essentially kind of carefully pop it up to remove the cover itself. And then over here on the right, they're talking about a sequence of removing the clips and the surround of the actual intake inlet. Then we have on here under number 4, disconnecting the temperature wire harness, which of course I can't see right now because it's underneath the cover. Then you have the removal of or loosen the hose clamp for the throttle body. Again, all of this stuff is sitting underneath the engine cover, and I'm just not going to be spending time showing all that because the pictures definitely match what the car has. And then of course number 5, as they have it in sequence, disconnecting the vent hose so that we can reconnect that later. And then that should allow us to take off the intake tube and pulling the whole thing right out. So here's actually the entire factory air assembly pulled out, minus the bottom of the air box. That's where I'm struggling with just a little bit, but it's actually kind of interesting to see how big this is, because again, considering the sophistication of the factory air intake, you have to sometimes question whether the aftermarket is really making a huge difference or not, because obviously a lot of effort went into designing this whole air exchange system. So we're just gonna drop our K&N filter here on top and go after the bottom part of the box, which is a little bit of a bear. The bottom part of the box, what we're struggling with is pulling it off of these frame molded, I don't know if you want to call them grommets or whatnot, to pull it off of there. But really, another real pain is this holder right here. Just might be hard, kind of hard to see, whether it's by squeezing around here or using a pair of pliers. We need to be able to loosen this bottom box part and have it come out along with the original actual air intake piece, because they are joined together. While we're in here, here's the engine cover off. Here's a favorite inlet. Might be a good idea to throw a towel over that or something, just to prevent any particles from entering, depending on what kind of garage environment or street environment you're working in. All right, we got the bottom of the airbox to come off the car. What definitely helped was actually disconnecting from the airbox, or just popping out the intake itself. And that created more room to wiggle around for the sake of the airbox. Important note, as in the instructions you will see, you have to retain, for use with the new system, you have to retain these rubber grommets. So make sure when you're pulling up the airbox, depending on how you're finagling it, some of these may come loose and drop into the engine, and then you might have a tough time getting them out. So just make sure you do not lose these things. So as part of the pre-assembly, before you actually go and put this inside the engine bay, you need to have the cone filter go inside the aftermarket airbox with a couple of clamps. So the fit is actually surprisingly good. I don't know if it's fair to say surprisingly. I'm sure it's intended to be that way, but the filter does not allow you, between how it's configured and how the size of the box is, to push it in any further than intended. So it comes, of course, with its own clamp, which is a 12 millimeter. But then on top of that, you also have to use a supplied clamp to go over the box piece of it to clamp down the filter position so that it's not moving inside the airbox. So, all said and done, we took out all this stuff and replaced it with this. The engine bay almost looks barren. I'm going to replace the cover and we should be good to go. The biggest pains for me in this install, directions could have been maybe a little bit better, but one of the pains was seating the aftermarket airbox on top of those frame-based rods, poles, whatever you want to call them, so that the grommets line up, and pressing the airbox into place firmly enough. That was a bit annoying. But the biggest, for me personally, pain was to run the new vacuum hose back to the back of the engine and trying to slip it on and connect it. In fact, I'd be curious to see how long this thing lasts, because there's no clamp provided for it, and you really needed to put some elbow grease and maybe some actual grease to get this thing on there. And there's a little bit of a kink that it forms right here with the aftermarket hose. So whether or not that's going to be a problem to be determined. I may end up figuring a way out to hijack the factory one, where it's much more of a sophisticated clamp, assuming I can ever get it out of this hard plastic surround, and maybe jerry-rig this because it has a nice knee in it to prevent kinks, even though it's narrower, so you would argue that might restrict some of the air flow, but regardless, to be determined. So once again, this is what we're looking at. Hope this was helpful. To be determined what this thing sounds like. I'm certainly going to try to run a few hard takeoffs and high revs just to see if sounding any different or feeling any different. And of course, the finished product, whether you decide to replace the cover or not. Looks wise, certainly is there, but hopefully we're going for more than just looks here, an actual function. So, to be determined. So, driving impressions. Under harder acceleration, and we're in eco mode right now, you can definitely hear the engine between about 2,500 and 4,000 RPMs. So you're not hearing that typical kind of suction sound, and when you let off the gas, you don't hear the kind of blow-off valve sounding whoosh, which again, that's more blow-off valve related for those cars. But with an air intake, the ones I've had before, sometimes you could get that kind of effect. Here, what you're definitely noticing is kind of the growly, throaty pickup of the engine in that RPM band. Now, we're going to attempt to go into sport mode just to see how much of a difference, if any, that ultimately makes. All right, sport mode on, eco mode off. Just get a straight line here, see what we get. There is a noticeable amount of sound coming from the front. Not so much like vibration, but certainly, again, that kind of growling, throating sound a little bit. There's no droning that this thing causes or anything like that when you're at the traffic light or just idling or whatever. You really don't notice much of a difference, if any. But like I said, certainly under pickup, and depending on how hard you're accelerating, between about 2,500, maybe even all the way up to 5,500, especially in sport mode.